Good morning, everyone. On Sunday mornings, I have been talking on this text, Opening the Hand of Thought. This book was written by my teacher, and I am one of the translators of this book. And my understanding of Dharma and practice is based on, my teacher's teaching. So to the people who practice here with me, I recommend you to read this book. And I have been talking on this text about 10 years. And I'm still page 113 in my record. This is 184th talk. So I talk each Sunday, each time, one paragraph. Today I'd like to talk on the paragraph, paragraph 4 of page 113. Let me read this paragraph. Taking as reality what proceeds division. We will not conjure up object of desire, opponents, competitions, and so on. As long as we are walking in this direction, we will not labor under the burden of greed, impatience, and envy. We will not go around cheating, deceiving, wounding, and killing one another. Rather, as true self, that is only true self, we possess absolute peace within us. At the same time, since we aim at manifesting the vigorous self that is here and now, and is simultaneously one with eternity, we need to make unceasing effort. This part of the text, Okumura Roshi, or my teacher, discuss about the meaning or significance of Zazen practice in modern civilization. And in the beginning of this part, he said the characteristic of modern civilization is putting too much emphasis on progress. That means to make things better even within ourselves, or ourselves to make this person better. Better means more desirable. So we set some goal. That means we feel there's something lacking within us or in the condition where we live. So there is something, dissatisfaction, and we feel we are not happy enough. So we think if we get something which is lacking, then we become happier, or we can be satisfied. So that is how, you know, we work hard to reach that goal. So this effort of making, working hard, is based on dissatisfaction. We are not good enough, or the world in which we are living is not good enough. Therefore, we have to work hard. And in order to reach that goal, efficiency is very important. That is how we live. Basically, we live in this modern society. and according to Buddha's teaching, you know, this working hard or making effort based on dissatisfaction, and also agreed to gain something we want, or anger or hatred against something we don't like about ourselves or about the situation we are living. And that is a kind of a perfect condition. You know, we make our lives into samsara. That means we suffer. You know, this dissatisfaction, anger and greed, based on ignorance. Those are called three poisons in Buddhism. And it seems the modern civilization is really functioning based on those three poisonous mind. And there is a very deep dissatisfaction there. So in this way of life, it's really difficult or almost impossible to find a peace of mind, because we have always gone somewhere else. We cannot stay peacefully here and now. Whichever you mentioned, that is a basic problem for us living, people living in modern civilization. But we also need a peace of mind. How can we find a peace of mind and also allow peace of mind which allow us to work hard instead of dissatisfaction, greed, or anger or hatred? What can be the energy or motivation to make effort and work hard without such a negative force? I think that is the Okumura Roshi point he wants to discuss, and he introduced Zazen or Buddha's teaching as a source of this energy or motivation to make effort without dissatisfaction and greed or anger or hatred. Is such a thing possible or not? If we think it's not possible, then no discussion anymore. We continue to practice, to live in this way until the end of civilization. So if there is something to change, or if there is some alternative direction we can take beside, you know, working hard to based on dissatisfaction or not. I think it's a very basic point of Dogen, not Dogen, but Okumura Roshi's discussion here. And he says that in Zazen, we sit, you know, Zazen is a sitting meditation. When we sit facing the wall, what we do is doing nothing. We keep this upright, straight posture and breathe through our nose deeply from the abdomen and letting go of thought. We don't have any object of meditation. We just keep this posture and deep breath and letting go of thought. So there's no object in our Zazen practice. By this letting go, we letting go of our discriminating mind, discriminating thinking. And this discrimination makes what is good, what is not good. I like this, I hate that. So by sitting and letting go, we sit in Okumura Roshi's expression, sit right on the ground of reality, in which all living beings are living together within interconnectedness. So our practice of Zazen or meditation is not the method to make this person greater but or better, but we stay here and now with peace. We have nowhere to go. We can just be here and now without struggling. But if we put too much emphasis on being here and now with peace, then we don't find why we have to work, why we have to make effort, what the direction. That is another point of Uchiyama Roshi's discussion here. That means, for example, in Japan had been a Buddhist country for many centuries. And for example, from 17th century until 19th century, for almost 300 years, you know, the population of Japan didn't change. And the basic structure of economy didn't change. Japan based on farming, and the method of farming, basically growing rice, didn't change. And of course, Japanese people made effort, work hard, but working hard didn't change the basic structure of economies. And in the culture, you know, Japanese people work for sophisticate each and everything, but not change industrial revolution happened in Europe. In Japan, we didn't have such a progress, but try to make everything sophisticated. So for almost 300 years within Japan, there's no war, no civil war. It was peaceful, so even the samurai or warrior didn't know how to fight. That was a problem when Japan had to open the country and compete with Europeans and other countries. And Japan, unfortunately, made a mistake. Japan became so much militaristic and materialistic, put too much emphasis on competition with European countries, try to catch up with them. Otherwise, Japanese thought we would become the colonies of European countries. Anyway, that was the situation of Japan when Uchiyama Roshi was young. That was early 20s. So, you know, the civilization of making progress in, we learned from Europe, from the West, and we Japanese people started to think peace of mind that was there before we influenced by Western civilization. That means we can continue what we do almost generation after generation without thinking about we have to change. So peace of mind and progress, making progress, should be together. That was, after I think about half a century after we received Western civilization, somehow we need to integrate the civilization of making progress and culture of finding a peace of mind. How these two can be together? That it was the question for Uchiyama Roshi when he was young, and he found the answer in Buddhism and then Zazen practice. So what he's saying is, within our Zazen, by letting go of thought, we stay before on the ground of reality, before any discrimination or separation. We let go of that kind of thinking, so we can stay peacefully here and now. But within this practice of being here and now with peace, Uchimura said we need to make effort. And you know, making effort is from the very beginning of Buddhist history or Buddha's teaching. Making effort is one of very important part of our practice. You know, within Eightfold Noble Path, there is diligent effort. And within the six parameters, also there is making effort. And there is another kind of list of such practice in Buddhist teaching called Hachidai Ninrak, or Eight Point of Awakening by Great Beings. It's kind of interesting. First two of those eight point or eight aspect of our practice is Shohaku. And the second is Chisoku. So this show means a few or small, and yoku is desire. Shoyoku so means having a few desires or small desires. That means we limit our desire. And the second way is chi is to know. And soku is satisfaction. Knowing satisfaction, or knowing how much is enough. So first and second is small or few desires, and knowing satisfaction. And one, two, three, or fourth of that eight Hachidai Ningaku is making effort, making diligent effort. So this is really interesting to me. If we have, we don't have many desires or big desires, and if we know satisfaction, then what is a driving force of this diligent effort? You know, if we work hard because of desire and because of dissatisfaction, what is this energy that makes us, you know, work hard? This is, as a Buddhist teaching, this is a very important point. And if we find the energy to make effort or work hard or to be diligent without desire and with satisfaction, then you know this can be the answer to the question: how can we integrate both, integrate the making progress and find that peace of mind? We have peace of mind and yet we can make effort. And even though we work hard, still that is not based on our desire or dissatisfaction. Is such a thing possible or not? I think it's a very important question, not only in Buddhism, but in everyone, all human beings living in this modern society, I think. And here Okumura Roshi is discussing, we can find that energy or direction to make effort, work hard, without desire and with satisfaction. And what is that? And he's talked about Zazen, sitting meditation practice. Within this Zazen, by letting go of thought, we let go of thought in our desire to be free from samsara. That means suffering. So our Zazen is not a method to, what is the word? To make change from, change our life from samsara to nirvana. But we sit even prior to division between samsara and nirvana. That means samsara and nirvana are kind of fiction made within our discrimination. So we have to let go even that separation between samsara and nirvana. And that is a very basic teaching of Mahayana Buddhism. Samsara and nirvana are one, and delusion and enlightenment are one. That is a reality based before any separation. And when we really settle down right there, then we are even released from our struggle to become enlightened. So Okumura Roshi, our Zazen practice is being settled down in the expression he used in this paragraph, absolute peace. I think that is a basis of what he's saying in this paragraph. So let me start to read this paragraph, sentence by sentence. Taking as reality what precedes division, the reality before or beyond that separation between this and that, or something variable or not variable, even delusion and enlightenment, or samsara and nirvana. We, in our Zazen, we settle down on that reality. Then we will not conjure up object of desire, opponents, competitors, and so on. As I always say, you know, we, in our thinking, we separate ourselves, self or subject, from object. There is a separation and we want to make connection based on my idea. And so we define what is this and we make evaluation if this is desirable or not, or important or not. And if we think this is important and desirable, I want to make this my possession. I want to get that. And if we think that thing, another thing, is not valuable or even harmful, then we want to stay away from this thing. But somehow this thing come to me without my agreement. So we become angry and we hate this. So we want to escape from this. And we want to chase after this because you know, we cannot get everything we want. So we have to work hard to gain that thing. That is how our life becomes a struggle to gain something or to escape from something. And that, you know, that running, our life becomes running towards something or escape from something. This running makes our life samsara, because sometimes we can feel our life is a success. I possess everything I need or I want. But more often, we keep having dissatisfaction. And often, no matter how much we get, we want to get more. So our life become like a hungry ghost, getting more and more and more. And when we reach certain goal, we still find a dissatisfaction and we want to go further. But more often, we don't feel our life is successful, or often we feel our life is a failure. And that, of course, that makes our life into suffering. So whether we are failure or winner, we suffer, and we always have fear, because things are changing. You know, future is uncertain, so we want to make our life secure. In order to do so, we want to gain more wealth, more than we really need for the future or for our children. So there's no time we can be free from desire, getting more, better and better. And we are always together with dissatisfaction or fear. If we think we have enough, then we have fear for losing this, or, you know, the desirable things are desirable not only me, but almost all human beings. So if we live with this motivation, you know, other people become competitor. And our life is competition with other people, not only our personal struggle to get that thing, but this entire society become competition. And that is what he's saying here, you know. Object of desire is what we want, and opponents and competitors. But when we settle down on the ground without such distinction or discrimination, or separation in between subject and object, when we settle down on that absolute peace, then we don't need to struggle to satisfy our desire or competitors or opponents. I think this is a kind of impossible thing in this modern society. But if we conclude this is not possible, this is only a thinking or idea, then, you know, this doesn't practice, or even Buddhist teaching doesn't make any sense, doesn't work in this world anymore. So we have to think how this can be possible if we are Buddha's student. And as long as we are walking in this direction, so he said there is a direction. And, you know, in the previous sentence, object of desire, this object in Japanese, Uchamroshi's Japanese word, Uchamroshi use is ate. And this direction is hōkō. And Uchamroshi is saying these two are completely different. Ate is object of desire. So until we get it, you know, our desire is not satisfied. So getting that thing or reaching that goal is important. Otherwise, our work or effort is worthless. But Uchiyama Roshi used this word hoko or direction. That means there is a direction. And we walk toward that direction. But reaching the goal is not a matter. We, each step walking that direction is the matter, is important. To reach there, to reach that goal or not, is not a matter. And in Buddhist teaching, or the Buddha's student called a Bodhisattva, the goal is Buddhahood, to become Buddha, together with all beings. That is a goal. But that goal is not possible to be reached. That is endless bound, endless direction. So when we think of our lives, there's no, you know, not being able to reach the goal is really clear. So reaching the goal is not a problem, not a matter. But taking each and every step toward that direction is important. This is called a Bodhisattva vow. So as a Bodhisattva vow, we vow to reach the Buddhahood together with all beings. But our more concrete vow is to take a step toward that direction. Whether to reach or not is not a matter. So in our practice, there is a goal, there is a direction. But reaching the goal or something we try to achieve is doable or not, or achieved, being achieved or not, is not a matter. But this making effort toward that direction is important. So as long as we are walking in this direction, we will not labor under the burden of greed, impermanence, impatience, greed, impatience, and envy. Greed and impatience are within ourselves, and envy is about, envy is about toward other people who compete with us to get the same thing. But if we work with this direction, means walking toward Buddhahood together with all beings, you know, there's no competitor. All of us are co-worker, working together. And we will not go around cheating, deceiving, wounding and killing one another, because our effort, working hard, is not not competition with others. Others are not enemies. So cheating or deceiving is not necessary if we really settle down on that ground of, in this case, interconnectedness. We are living together with all beings, and each being is supporting each other. If we live based on this, not idea, but for Buddhists, this reality, then there's no enemy or no competitors. But the enemy and the competitor are created within our mind. In this structure, separation between self and others. Some others looks like enemy, and actually they attack us. So we cannot negate there are some people who are enemy for us, or some people who attack us. But that is the world produced in our mind. So when Uchamura said the reality of letting go of thought, we letting go of this world picture of, you know, friend and enemy. But rather, as true self, that is only true self. We settle down within the self. And when Uchan Roshi uses for true self, that means the self which, before making this separation between self and others. So, as I always like, this is Indra's net, and we are existing part of this net. And within this net, everything is connected with everything. And yet, because the thread is not seen, we think we are separate and individual each other. So, and we make a kind of a separation or like a walls between me and the rest of the world. But in Buddhist teaching, that is a fiction. There's no such separation or fences or walls, or even fences or walls are something connect ourselves to the rest of the world. So as true self, that is only true self, means we are all connected with all beings. We possess absolute peace within this practice. Absolute peace within us. So our life is not competing with others. So there's no winner and loser. And at the same time, since we aim at manifesting the vigorous self, so we manifest the vigorous life. That is here and now. As I said last week, you know, self here and now. In Dogen teaching, one thing, self is not separate from rest of the time, that means past and future. And self is not separate from here and there. So just being here now and being the self is together with all beings. And in that sense, this entirety of interconnectedness is ourself. And he said, we aim at manifesting this life here, now, and this self, and everywhere, all the time, and all beings are really one. Really one, because this self here and now is zero. That is what I said, I talked last week. Because this is, we think this is one, and that is true. This is kind of individual, but when we closer look at this, we find this is zero. And because exactly this, because this is zero, this entirety of this network is the self. So in that sense, this one equal zero equal infinity. That is a kind of my understanding of Mahayana Buddhist teaching and at least Dogen's teaching. So we try to live based on this understanding of reality of our life. You know, I'm a Shohaku. and I'm not you, and you are not me. So I have to take care of my life, take care of my five skandhas, and I have to make decision what I should do in each moment here and now. And now I am a speaker, so I try to play a role as a speaker, as a teacher of this Buddhist temple. That is what I'm doing. But what I'm doing is a connection with entire past, and because of what I'm doing this, there is some influence to the future. You know, I'm not such a great person, but basically what Shakyamuni did was the same as what I'm doing. I don't think my teaching or my action has so much, you know, big influence to the future, but Shakyamuni's activity and his effort to share what he awakened to, that is, I believe that is this reality. You know, I think completely make change the human history. That means if Buddhism doesn't exist in this world, in the history of humanity, then I think that human civilization is really different. So Shakyamuni's personal awakening and effort to share that awakening, I think, change the entire history of human civilization, at least spiritual civilization. What I'm doing will not have such a big influence, but no matter how small it can be, but basically the same. So what we do here and now is really connected with entire time and space. That is why we have to be careful and mindful. What is what we are doing and what is the motivation of this action? Because my actions and my motivation of doing this thing have influence to others within the space and time. That means there's a possibility, as Shakyamuni's activity made such a huge influence to entire human world. You know, there is a possibility that through each one of us's effort, we may change the world. I think we need this phase. Otherwise, what we are doing is really meaningless. And, you know, Uchiyamura uses this word, aim at. I mean, this aiming at is a kind of interesting expression. Because when Dogen or Uchiyamura talks about other than said there's nothing to aim. But here he said we have to aim at. And this aiming at is the direction we need to walk. So here is two opposite aspect, that is, everything is okay as it is, and we don't need to go somewhere else. We can stay here with absolute peace. So we don't need to go anywhere, and still we need to go somewhere. That we need to aim at something, and this something is to live based on this reality, so we have to aim at to keep us awakening to this reality, and not only awakening is not thinking. When we awaken to that reality, we have to behave, take actions on that basis. That means living together with all beings, not for make this person winner, and that means make other people loser. That is not the way we live. That is not what we aim at. But what we have to aim at is how we can be living together with all beings with peace and harmony. That is the direction for our effort. So this direction and our effort, this diligence, is not for fulfilling our desire to make ourselves more important and powerful and a winner. But how can we live together with all beings, sharing our life? That is what we have to aim at. So because we have the aim and vigorous self manifesting our vigorous self, that is our life, is here, that is here and now. So we have to work hard, making effort here and now, to be really here and now, together with all beings. And that is our direction. But the problem is we often forget this. And especially when we go out of the zendo, even though when we are sitting in the zendo, kind of we can stay in this peace and harmony. But once we get out of the zendo, we think there's a different world. And we have to return to the world of competition. And we, you know, work hard or make effort to compete with others and become a winner. That's why we need to make effort not to go that direction, but to stay living together with all beings. And he said, when we work with that attitude here and now in peace with all beings, I think he said, and he said, is simultaneously one with eternity. I talked about what eternity meant last week. It's not a permanence in my understanding. There's nothing permanent in Buddhist teaching, but this eternity is a time before separation. Before separation means we make separation present, past, and future. And this separation is a production of our thinking. That means we measure the time, you know, before this moment, that is in the past, and we can calculate how many years ago, how many centuries ago, and that separation into segment, yesterday, today, tomorrow, that is production of our thinking. So when we stop measuring that, measuring time with that separation or segment, then time is time from the beginningless beginning, even before Big Bang, to the end, endless end, is one single moment, one seamless moment. There's no such segment. Segment is made within human mind. And I think this time with that segment, that means that time that doesn't flow is eternity. And within this, there's no separation between self and others, or here and there, or present and past or future. This is entirely one thing. So simultaneously one with eternity. And we need to make an unceasing effort in order not to forget this reality and really live based on this reality. We have to make effort. So here we can find energy or motivation to work hard, to make effort, not because of this fulfilling desire or dissatisfaction. This is what Okumura Roshi is saying. And when we just read this paragraph or this text, this is simply just a kind of idea. So we need to find, I think, concrete example. And when I studied Dogen, what he said in the concrete things, we can find this attitude. That means Dogen, after he came back from China, Dogen founded his own monastery. But that monastery didn't have a complete buildings as a, to function as a monastery. So Dogen tried to build a most important building in the monastery. That was a monk's room, where monks stayed, sleep, and meditate, and eat. And so he made an effort to raise fund to make to construct that building. And he wrote an appealing letter. So he was making effort to establish first Zen monastery in Japan, Soto Zen monastery in Japan. So he was making effort. But this is from Shobo Genzo Zenmonki. He talks about this effort. So he making effort toward that direction, means to introduce and establish the place where Japanese people could practice Zen. He says, currently, I am appealing for donations and working as much as possible to construct the monk's hall. I don't think that this necessarily contributes to the flourishing of the Buddha Dharma. This means he's making effort of fundraising, not for construction of the building. But he says, only because there are few people who are studying the way right now at his monastery, and because I am spending my days leisurely, so he was not so busy. Do I think it better to engage in these activities, means working for constructing the monk's hall, than be idle? I hope this will enable deluded people to form a connection with Buddha Dharma. Deluded people means common people can have a connection with Dharma by making donation. So this effort for fundraising itself is working for Dharma, to allow to make common Japanese people to have a connection with Dharma. So I'm working on this project for the sake of founding a dojo or practice place for Zazen practice for the people studying the way in this age. So he has a goal or a direction, and he is working hard. But he says, next he says, I will have no regret. I will have no regret even if what I have wished for and begun and wished for and begun might not be realized. So he is not afraid of failure. And he said, I do not mind if but one single pillar is erected, as long as people in later generations think that someone had the aspiration to carry out such a project but did not complete it. So he is working hard to establish a practice place. But he said he is not afraid of failure. To me, this is really important, especially when I lived in Massachusetts, in a small place where in the Western Massachusetts, and we didn't have money, and we didn't have any connection, much connection with the American society. But somehow we were sent by our teachers to establish that, that makes that place into Zendo or Zen communities. So there's no financial support, and only three of us working there. So to me, that was the question: how could this, you know, project or mission be accomplished or completed? And I couldn't find any possibilities. But when I read this section of the monkey, I found, you know, to achieve that goal is not a problem. It's not a matter or not important. But working here and now for us, whatever we can do, that is, in a sense, that is a goal. When we work for that, you know, the goal is already there. And this has something to do with one of the very basic teaching of Dogen. That means practice and realization or verification are one. That means when we make effort, the goal is already there or manifested within what we are doing. So what we do, doing what we need to do here and now, is the only thing we have to be careful of. Whether it's what we are trying to do is accomplished or not is not so important. Of course, we have to make all the effort we can to toward that direction, but that, the achievement or fulfillment of that project is not only depend on our effort, but it depends on the situation of entire entire situation of this country. So that was kind of relief for me. So we can focus on just doing what we need to do and we can do here and now. And that effort bring the future, whether that is something we expect or not. But this motivation or energy to work hard here and now for the Dharma, not because of desire fulfilling our personal desire or dissatisfaction. Well, this is what I have to say this morning. I'm sorry, again, I talk too long. but do you have any question or comments? Please.
So, I'm wondering if you can say a few words about when you when you go through everyday life and you you're confronted with people that seem to have such a gap between ways of thinking, ways of being. So what, even knowing that that gap is a fiction, what do you, what can you do?
You know, during the Genzoe, someone asked what Buddha did when his clan or nation was all killed. You know, he was from a clan or tribe named Shakya. And Shakya was a small country in Nepal, but the small country, his country or nation, was kind of belongs to the larger kingdom called Kosala. And, you know, when Buddha lived, Buddha was alive, India was not a peaceful country. You know, the big powers fight each other and trying to make kind of a unified entire India. And when Buddha was old, aged, the king of Kosala attacked Buddha's country called Shakya clan. And Buddha tried to stop the king to attack his nation three times. And first two times, the Buddha, not the king, changed his mind and returned. But the third time, Buddha was sitting under a dead tree. And when the king was walking toward the Shakya clan's country, he found Buddha was sitting under the dead tree, and the king asked the Buddha, "Why are you sitting under the dead tree instead of a tree with many leaves where, you know, there is a shade and he could sit more comfortably?" But what Buddha said was, the shade of a family or clan was very comfortable. That was the only thing Buddha said. And on that time, Buddha didn't stop the king to attack his nation. So that was what Buddha did. So in such a situation, we need to find what we could do. But for Buddha, at least for Shakyamuni, to attack that king was not his choice. To fight against the enemy, then he could be the hero of that, of his clan, but could not be a Buddha. So I think we have to learn what we could do in such a situation. Means obviously there is how can I say, conflict or even fighting in many places in this world now. Even, you know, we don't have war, you know, like in Japan there's no war, but there is conflict, and people have think, you know, we and they. And what we can do as a Buddha student is, how can we find a kind of a common ground on which all living beings, not only human beings, are living together within interconnectedness? How can we, how can I say, remind or show that we are living together in this small, tiny planet. And we now, human beings, have power to completely destroy that interconnectedness within on this planet. So important point is fighting each other or killing each other are really, how can I say, harming ourselves. I think that is one thing we could do or one thing we should do within such a situation. Does this make sense? Okay, thank you. Anything else? Good. Okay, thank you for listening. Thank you.